In this video, we're going to discuss automatic demand distribution and demand import. Automatic demand distribution is handled from the Build Edit tab, underneath which there's a Demands submenu where we find automatic demand distribution. We'll cover distributing demands to residential meters, distributing demands to junction nodes, and distributing demands to a subset of junction nodes. In the Automatic Demand Distribution menu, there are two tabs: pipe diameter-based distribution and polygon-based distribution. Polygon-based distribution is the simpler of the two options. All it requires is the total demand to distribute, which is in your model's flow units. The model's flow units can be seen here, under the Settings tab, in the System Data menu. The way this polygon-based distribution works is that more densely clustered areas of piping receive less overall demand per pipe, and less densely clustered areas of piping receive more overall demand per pipe. So, this more highly branched area of piping would receive more overall demand than somewhere like this central area, for instance. The pipe diameter-based distribution, on the other hand, allows the user more options. It relies on this table to distribute demands based on pipe diameter, with the smaller diameter pipes receiving more of the demand than the larger diameter pipes. The relationship can be influenced using this slider called the Demand Distribution Factor. Sliding the slider all the way to the left would mean that the demands were distributed solely based on pipe length. Sliding it to a normal value of 1.0 weights the distribution based on diameter. Specifically, more demand is applied to smaller diameter pipes and less demand to larger diameter pipes, although in an expected distribution. And we can exaggerate that effect by sliding the demand distribution factor further to the right if we wish. Next, we need to select what values to calculate, and depending on what we choose, one of these inputs will be grayed out. For instance, if we choose number of residential meters, we'll be asked for the average demand per meter, that is to say per connection, and the total demand to distribute. If we choose average demand per meter, we'll be asked for the number of residential meters and the total demand to distribute. That's most commonly what the modeler will know ahead of time. And the last option is that we know the total demand to distribute, so we'll be asked for the number of residential meters and how much each meter is using. In any case, the amount to distribute is going to show up here, so that amount will be distributed to the entire system. The only exception is if we check this box, in which case the demand will be distributed to a subset of the system, specifically a selected group of pipes, or possibly the nodes associated with that group of pipes. We'll talk more about that soon. When we apply the demand, we have two options. The first option is to apply the demand as residential meters, and the second option is to apply it at junction nodes. If you choose to apply it at junction nodes, the demands will appear in the demand field in the node info window and are presented in the model's flow units. So, for instance, at this junction node, there are existing households or businesses that use an average of 4.5 gallons per minute. In order to see residential meters, however, we need to click on a pipe. Here's the field for residential meters. There are none existing in the model at this time, but if they were here, this is where we would see them. As stated, each represents a connection with an average demand. So, we can choose to apply our additional demands as residential meters or at junction nodes. But first, let's see what's already in the model using the label menu. we'll click on this drop-down list to bring up the menu. And on the right-hand side, where the node labels are, we'll check the box for demands. Closing out of this menu, we see all the demands in the model. Doing this shows you that the process of distributing the new demands is going to overwrite all the existing demands in the model. So now we're going to open up the automatic demand distribution menu and press the middle radio button, where we're going to place 1,000 residential meters with a total demand of 1,000 GPM. So, once we have our inputs in, we can slide the demand distribution factor slider if we want to, although in this case, we're going to leave it as is. And then we simply click Apply this demand as residential meters, and then exit. We can see, by looking in the map area, that our junction demands have gone away. They're all zeros. However, in the pipe labels portion of the label menu, I can turn on the number of residential meters, although I'll also turn off the extra prefix and suffix information. And in the map area, we'll now see a quantity of connections, and we'll zoom in to better see our distribution. And when I say quantity, I don't mean it has to be a whole number. It can be a fractional number instead. And if later we need to adjust the average flow per residential meter, that's done here. Now we'll apply the same demands, but at junction nodes as opposed to as residential meters. First, we'll pull up the automatic demand distribution menu. And remember that once we run this application, it overwrites all the existing demands in the model. So it will eliminate our residential meters in favor of the new junction demands. Next, we'll click Apply this demand at junction nodes. And we see our new junction demands have been created by looking in the map area. Next, let's say we have some new demands we want to add to our model, and we want to use the Apply to Selected Pipes option. First, we'll go into Group Mode and select a subset of our network. Now we have two options. We can either append our new demand data to this selected area, or we can overwrite the existing demands. Let's say we want to choose the first option. That is to add the new demands to the existing demands. Let's zoom in to a subset of our selection so we can tell that we've successfully appended the new demand data. Here we see values like 6, 7.1, 9, and 1.7 at some of our junction nodes. In the automatic demand distribution menu, we'll make sure the radio button is pressed for number of residential meters, and we'll add an average demand per meter of 1 GPM, distributing a total demand of 200 GPM. And then check the box to apply to selected pipes. Now, when we click the box to apply this demand at junction nodes, it's going to ask us if we want to delete the existing demands first, and we'll say no. If we say yes, it will delete all the demands in the model, which we don't want. Now, when we exit, we can see that we've increased the existing demands at the junction nodes in the area of the selected pipes. But the non-selected junctions haven't had their demands increased. Next, let's say we want to replace the demands in the selected area instead. First, we need to zero out the existing demands. But we don't want to delete all the demands everywhere in the model. only those in the area of the selected pipes. Therefore, the procedure is as follows. While we have these nodes selected in Group Edit mode, we'll refresh the Node Info window, then click on the row header for Demand, then click on New Value, and enter a 0 in this field. Now, when I apply the edit and click OK, all the demands in the junctions of the selected pipes are zeroed out, but these other demands in the non-selected junctions remain the same. Now, to emplace our new demands, we can go back to the Automatic Demand Distribution menu. We'll apply the same amount. We'll check the box to apply to selected pipes, and then click the button to apply this demand at junction nodes. Click No, after which we can exit, and see that we have successfully added the new demands to the junction nodes within our selected pipes, but only to those junctions within our selected pipes. Next, we'll cover demand import. The data source for the demand import is an Excel file, and we need to have a model already built, one that references internet maps. So, for this example, this model has Google Maps turned on. And it has pipes laid out in the appropriate areas. The Excel spreadsheet contains usage data for users in this area. Usage data is often provided in units of volume per month or per day. But that has to be converted to the model's flow units, which in this case are gallons per minute. So we have a column here with that conversion. The spreadsheet also needs to contain location data for each user. This could be an address or XY or lat-long coordinates. We could also use a node name if we happen to have that information entered in our spreadsheet. But for this example, we'll be using addresses. Once we have the spreadsheet set up the way we want it, it's important to save it as a tab-delimited text file. And then close it out, so it won't be open in another application during the import process. Now in our model, we'll click on Build Edit, Demands, Import Demands, and then we'll browse for our tab delimited text file. We can choose to distribute these demands as node demands at junctions or as metered connections within pipes. Our location type is address, but as mentioned, we could use XY or lat-long coordinates or node name. Next, we'll type in the address postfix. That's going to be the city and state or city and country that the addresses come from. Next, we'll match the appropriate data columns. In the spreadsheet, our addresses are in column A, and our demands in the model's flow units are in column B. Last, we do have a header row, so our data doesn't begin until row 2. Thus, we can accept these defaults. Below that are some debugging features that we won't use for this example. Now we're going to process this file. Once it's complete, we see a diagnostic message telling us which demands cannot be processed by row, as well as the total demands that were assigned. I know from looking at the spreadsheet that we started with approximately 280 GPM worth of demands, and we see that the majority of that was processed. In general, you want to keep your addresses as simple as possible. As an example, you'll want to eliminate any kind of symbol, including hashtags and parentheses. So now, we'll turn off Internet and Maps to better see our labels when we check our data import. Next, we'll turn on Demands in the Label menu. And zoom into a portion of the map area to better see the results of our data import. Also, as a last note about the data source for the addresses, if we go to Appearance, Internet Maps, and then to the Elevations Addresses tab, here we have the address source. The default is to acquire our addresses from census.gov. However, MapQuest and MapBox are available with the KYPipe premium package, and most often result in superior address capture.